You can't spend time with God and not end up like God. When you spend time with God, you come out as God. God said to Moses, after he spent time with him, go and tell Pharaoh. He said, you shall be God in his stead. Exodus 7:1.
Amen.
You spend time with God, you appear like God before men. Some of you looking for a job, spend time with God in your CV. With life. When you knock the door of the company, they say, we have been waiting for you. We have been waiting for you. Not that you don't wake up from sleep, carry your CV. You say, I'm looking for a job. They say, cut out and get away from that place. Don't I have brother that will employ or sister? Or they begin to give you condition, come and join our court. Until you become a court, we'll give you a job. Why? You don't know the formula. Look, there are two kingdoms in this world, the kingdom of light and the kingdom of darkness. The kingdom of darkness is against you. Let me tell you now, in case you don't know. So you want to stand with them, you need warfare mentality. You generate unction so you can function. Without unction, you can't function. It takes unction to function. That's the problem we have with many believers. Fold your hands so their life is full. Quickly. 5 reasons why you must pray and fast. Number 1. Reasons why you must pray and fast. I'm sure you are recording this message. It's worth recording. And we'll forward it to members of this church in their phones. So that they will play it again. Not after this 1 hour you go. You go outside, sit and say, don't bother that thing the guy is talking. Not everybody is going meant to go forward. You too, you can be here. We are no problem. Just stay. So you hear the message again and again and refire yourself. That's why as you always buy these things from the studio. If you can't buy it, carry your phone. Let them save it for you. Studio, save it to their phone. Hear better thing, message. Don't be hearing rubbish thing online. Some of you take pleasure in watching porn. Pornographic things. How will your spiritual life go up now? Set yourself on fire by creating the atmosphere. Play a message. Minimum 3 a day. Most of you who are working in the bank, I told the young man, he said, how he goes. I said, are you listening to message in that place here? I said, that's why you're making it back. Steady, fire yourself up. You have your phones, load Bible inside your phone. Don't be going to Facebook. Facebook, most of us, our idol is Facebook. I've told you before, take your eyes out of Facebook and face this book called the Bible. Face this book, leave Facebook. Why must I pray? Number 1. It's a kingdom command. It's a kingdom command. It's a kingdom command. Luke chapter 18 verse 1. Men ought always to pray and not to faint. Luke 18:1. Men ought always to pray and not to faint. So once you're a man, once you're a woman, you're mandated to pray. Men ought always. Do I have men here? Do I have women here? You ought to pray and not to faint. If you don't pray, you faint. If you don't pray, you fall. If you don't pray, you die. The die is spiritual death. Prayer makes your spirit man alive. Man is a spirit, has a soul, lives in a body. What makes your spirit man alive is prayer. There are many people spiritually dead. Satan is coming to your family to destroy somebody. Because you are spiritually dead, you can't see it. Can I tell you something? You are hearing this for the first time. Sometimes God mentions the name of some of you to pray for. Or you begin to use your name to pray. That person is about to enter an attack. I don't understand what you understand as a prophet. I don't know. A prophet by privilege is God's seers and God's voice. They see things by grace. Their perception is enhanced. Sometimes they rise up and pray for the church. Somebody, a criminal, an armed robber is coming to your house. Rise up and pray. That prayer make them lose their address. They are going. They say, okay, let's branch this house. When they finish the house, they were coming to your house too. Because of the prayer of the spirit of adjustment, they branch another house. Before you know, the day dawn, they say, okay, let's go. That's how you exempted. And such people, because of spiritual deafness, they may still come to church and still be fighting the pastor. Because they are blind spiritually. So, God say, okay, their fruitfulness anointing is in your hands. If you don't pray for them, nothing will work. Such people, they still hate the pastor. They fight the pastor. Why? Spiritual deafness. So, will be speaking against the grace that would have made them rise. So they end up in disgrace. Prayer makes you spiritually alive. Listen, man is a spirit, has a soul. This is the body. What is the spirit of a man? That's the living man. That spirit man is only alive by prayer. A soul is the will, the mind, the emotion. When you are prayerful, you're always excited and happy. You just have hope for tomorrow because you are in fellowship with one who has tomorrow. So you're not shaking. If your father is very rich, are you afraid of financial poverty? No. You know, when you see rich men's children, there's a way they talk with confidence. Why? They have experienced wealth. They are not used to trekking, they are not used to suffering, they are not used to lack of. When you put food for them on the ground, they will not eat it because they are used to dining table. Hello. You know, poor men children, they don't know what dining table is. I'm sure you're not offended because you're not poor. Amen. I just need to tell you the truth. Amen. Now, so you know, some people, they can be 9 people staying in one room, staying in public toilet. All the food they put on the ground. You can't have one room. I'm talking of dining now. Where would you put the dining inside the one room? Amen. So they are used to eating on the ground, so it becomes a ladder. But a rich man who's coming from where only him has an apartment. His room is in suit, his toilet, his bedroom, inside his room. Everything. He has wardrobe. They don't share cloth or drag cloth. You know, some people borrow cloth. Even this, as I'm talking now, there are people who borrow cloth. Am I lying? Borrow cloth, borrow shoe, even makeup. They borrow makeup. Sister Lucy, give me that your. Lucy, let me just. That's borrow. What is borrow? Collecting what's not your own to use it temporarily to return. Are you there? But a rich man's child is not used to it. Amen. So when you give him food on the ground, he won't rush at it. You see, when you see a rich man go to a kitchen, he doesn't drop a food. Hey, give me. Never give me. Give me. Hey, you never pass this line. This line. That's poor poverty. Are you hearing me? So because you know what? Where he's coming from or she's coming from, they are used to abundance. So he considered it a shame for him to be calling for food. When David gave him the food, he takes it with some as if I don't need it. A jebotic taking. Not before some have rest their hand. Are you hearing me? Now, listen to what I'm trying to say. Your father who commanded you to stay in prayer is a God of abundance. If you spend time with him, there's a way you carry yourself. You carry yourself well. You talk well. You talk like the son of your father. How can your father be a governor or a president? A teacher will be slapping you 5 times and caning you for what? The school will be closed. Are you there? The problem many believers have, they don't know the father who they have because they're not spending time with him. Look, you can preach about God and still not know God. It's only encounter that reveals God to you. Encounter. You know, it's possible for you to say, there are people in this church perhaps who know me from a distance. One, since I've been here 1 year, they've never entered my office. Number two, they've never spent time more than 10 minutes talking with me. Number three, they've never visited my house and they're members of this church. What do they know about me? They only know me in the altar. They don't know me. They can talk about me, but they don't know me. But there are people who have entered inside my room and sit on my bed. Those ones can tell about me. Say, I know that guy. That guy is going somewhere. This something about that guy. They can describe because of the encounter. What am I saying? They say, when you spend time with God, you can tell who God is because of your time. That's why I say men ought always to pray. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 17, he said, pray without ceasing. That means don't cease. Keep praying. Why must I pray? It's a command to be consistent in your prayer. Thank you, Jesus. Now, for example, as I'm talking to you now, there are some who may be doubting, but my wife will not doubt. You know why? She knows me. There are times she wants to talk to me. When she looks at my eye, she just go. I didn't tell her go, she just go. she can see fellowship with the Holy Ghost. She has seen some dimension. But you may not understand. Thank you, Jesus. So once you're a man, you're mandated to pray. Number two, it's a platform for making your request known. Why must I pray? Number two, it's a platform for making your request known. Philippians chapter 4 and verse 6. Be anxious for nothing. Be careful for nothing. But by prayer. Hey, in everything by prayer. So pray for everything. Pray for everything. You are traveling to Yaoundé, pray, because you may not arrive there. Don't assume that you traveled before and went there. That this coming this time you can arrive. Pray in everything. Pray. You see, scripture teaches us everything. You are loaded. See, another problem again. If you don't pray, you cannot even understand the scripture. You know why? This scripture were written by anointed men. They wrote it in the spirit. You can read it and not understand it. But if you're a man of the spirit, you can see into what they're showing you. In everything, pray. By prayer. So prayer is a platform of converting your desire to your manifestation. It's a platform of converting your desire to your manifestation. It's a let by in everything by prayer and supplication and with thanksgiving. Let your request be made known unto God. Too many people complain and murmur. Why? They don't know the demand. He said, make it known to God. Don't complain. Don't murmur. Make it known. I don't know if this happened to you. When I carry burdens to God, even when I've not seen the answer, the burdens was off me. I tell you, I pray for somebody who's believing God for something. The thing look big, that is a big miracle by me. But once I pray, even if I can't see change, I believe. You know why? My big father is enough to handle this matter. It's beyond me. I've handed it over to him. I relax. And suddenly, he produced testimony, revelation. You see, insight enables you to gain great heights in life. It's a product of insight. So it's a platform of making your request known. It's not a place of complaining, murmuring, and all that. That's why many people, you know, seem to be forced. They complain a lot. But prayer is a channel of converting your desire, making it known to God. God wants to hear. God wants you to pray. God wants you. He said, they ask not, they receive not because they ask not. Can I request for extra little time? Or should we just close? Eh? Okay, give me a few minutes more. Amen. After all, when they used to play match and sometimes there's extra time. And this one is better than match. Praise God. It's true. And you watch the match. When you finish, they won't give you anything. You are watching Drogba, Romario, and all of them. Arsenal, Chelsea. All the Chelsea fans are there. All the Gunners are there. When you finish watching, you argue, they didn't give you anything. They say extra time, you waited. You even paid to watch. This one now, you didn't pay to come. Extra time to feed you more. So you better just exercise a little more patience. Amen. Hallelujah. What am I saying? In James chapter 4, verse 2, he said, ye ask not. He said, you ask and receive not because you ask amiss. That, go to verse 2 before you come to verse 3, please. Verse 2 said, ye lost and have not, and kill and desire to have and cannot obtain. Ye fight and war, yet ye have not because you ask not. In other words, you didn't have because you didn't ask. Somebody say, what of the earlier verse? He said, because you asked, you are lost. What is the motive behind your asking? Lord, give me car. Let me show them in this church. All those girls that think they're fine, I will finish them now. God said, hey, that's your motive. Be tracking. Lord, give me money. Let me show this pastor's wife that I can dress better than her. God said, hey, for competition, you never have it. Lord, give me husband. Let all these members in the choir know that I'm the best woman around them. If you're asking for financial breakthrough to promote the kingdom, it's already done before it comes. Lord, I want to plant churches for you. Lord, I want to minister to your servants. Because if I lift up the hands of gospel preachers, I'm lifting up the kingdom. Satan is fighting. Now, let me also say this one here. Satan is fighting promoters of the gospel. God, pastors, prophets, apostles. Church members are joining to fight them. How can a pastor be looking so good now? How can he be dressing so well? You know why? You lack revelation of the assignment. That's why you're seeing so. You're looking them as humans. They should look dirty and rapid and let the kingdom assignment scatter, spoil. No, I'm telling you the truth. We've seen it in the kingdom. There are members who Satan anoints to also fight leadership. Yes, it's true. You know why? Satan is fighting the kingdom, not just the man of God. So that he can't do the job with excitement. He can't do, because could you imagine that if what I would have come here to preach or spend time with God to develop myself, I'm going to do business in a main market. Hey, what's the business I'm gonna, every day you are seeing me in main market, I would have lost my value. Are you there? Because if there is financial lack, I will go to Egypt. Did you see that Joseph, Jacob's, his children, they went to Egypt because there was famine in the land? So God has made provision that they will be comfortable so they can focus on his assignment. So people say, hey, how can they be? Yeah, it's too much for them. How can they be using jets? How can they be using fire car? Who should use it? Politicians who are killing people every day, they should use it. Or footballers who doesn't have anything to add to your life should use it. Are you seeing now how Satan fights? Or thieves, 419s, should be driving the best car, using aeroplane, all the best things of life. When God told you, my children, he said, it is your father's will to give you the good things of this kingdom. Everything good is your entitlement in Christ. Glory to God. So the meaning of that scripture, yeah, these are the reasons. Now, what am I trying to say? The motive. So we pray because a platform of making your request known. He now concludes by saying, ye ask, ye receive not because you didn't ask. In other words, it's a platform of making your request known. Number three. It's a platform of fellowship with the Father. Why do we pray? The reason, number three, is a platform of fellowship with the Father. That means it's a platform of intimacy. It's a platform of koinonia. It's a platform of fellowship. 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 14. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet, I don't know how this happens to you. How sweet. You can't buy that with money to spend time with the Holy Ghost. Where you'll be dictating things to you, talking to you, making you feel good. Out of this world, out of experience. Sometimes my wife drops food, appetite lost, because what I'm doing with him. He just suspends my physical body. I sink to the spiritual realm. The joy that I cannot explain, not because there's money, but because I can't explain. I think that's what the scripture says. Joy unspeakable, full of glory. It's glorious. That's what you get. 2 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 14. He said, and there's sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit. There's a place of intimacy. You see, okay, let me give an example. Men who love their wife, how do you see how that feels? Or women who truly love their husband. There's this kind of thing you can't explain. You just want to be with the person all the time, two of us. If your husband didn't call you, or you know, didn't send you text all day long, you will feel somehow, because you'll be expecting the two of us. Wanna talk now? It's not true. Even when you are still in relationship, self, the guy didn't call you for 2-3 days, you are fidgeting as somebody has carried him. True. So 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 14. Sweet fellowship. So prayer as a platform of fellowship. I call it intercourse with the Spirit. Intercourse with the Spirit. I mean, it's so sweet. It's so, you can't explain it with words. And, you know, in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 2, scripture says, he said, he that speaketh on one tongue, speaking unto men, but unto God. Why be it in the Spirit? He speaketh mysteries to God. He's talking to God, not men. And God asks for that. God wants to hear from you. God wants you to talk to him. When you wake up in the morning, you jump up to walk, you didn't spend time with him. He said, I'm missing you. I love you so much. I want to hear you talk to me. I need fellowship from you. I want to make your life better. I created you. You can't live your life better than outside me. Take me out of your life. Your life is frustrated. Please let me help you. That's what he's saying. Number four, it's a platform of warfare. It's a platform of warfare and intercession. It's a platform of warfare and intercession. In other words, prayer is also given as a platform of warfare and intercession. In Acts chapter 12, we saw how a wicked spirit came upon Herod and he took James and killed him. Acts chapter 12, from verse 1 to 7. And as he killed James, he went and apprehended Peter, because the wicked spirit also made some other, you know, the Jews, they were happy. Okay, would you read it from the scripture? Now, and he killed James, the brother of John, with a sword. Go to the next verse quickly. And when he saw that he pleased the Jews were happy. Oh, they have killed those people that are preaching the gospel. So it's not today they started fighting pastors. Are you hearing? No surprise. He proceeded to seize Peter also. But thank God this time the church have repented. And those were the days of unleavened bread. Go to verse 4 quickly. And when he had taken him, he put him in prison and delivered him to four quaternions of soldiers. Not one, four. Can you see? When they catch thief, they didn't give up. They catch the pastor, they give up and kill him. Wicked spirit. To guide him, intending that after the Passover, they will bring him to the people. Now verse 5. Peter therefore was kept in prison. But prayer, this time people wake up. Say, no, enough is enough. But prayer was made earnestly to the church for him. Earnestly. This time they say, we don't agree. Enough is enough. We don't agree. Enough is enough. Prayer was made. Now, look at what happened. The ministry of angels are activated in the place of prayer. Go to the next verse. And when Herod was brought, was about to bring him, please get back there. But before you come back, when Herod was about to bring him forth, the same night Peter was sleeping between two soldiers, bound and chained in his neck, and guard before the door kept the prison. I'm showing you how to break limits now. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood by him. What brought him? The prayer of the church. Stood by him, and a light shined in the cell. I see light shining in your destiny. And he smote Peter on the side and awoke him. Everything causing you to sleep, wake you up now. Say, rise up quickly. Your destiny, your miracle shall come quickly. And his chain fell off from his hands. I don't know any chain that hold you down. As I speak now, that chain fall off. In the name of Jesus. So the ministry of angels was activated, and Peter was set free from being killed. What am I saying? Look, prayer is a platform of warfare and intercession. Most of you allow your relative, your loved one, die because you refuse to pray. And you know what? The Bible says that blood will be on your neck. Failure to pray. You see, because if you're not sensitive, when would you know how to pray? Now, what is warfare? And what is intercession? I think I should define it to help you. Warfare simply means establishing the will of God in spite of opposition in battle. Establishing the will of God in spite of opposition in battle. Warfare simply means establishing the will of God in spite of opposition. That's warfare. Thank you, Jesus. What is intercession? It is standing in the gap for an individual or a family or a territory or a nation. Standing in the gap for individuals, for a nation or a territory. That's what intercession is. When you see us interceding for unsaved souls, that's what we're doing. We are trying to pull them out of the hand of the devil. You see, when you find an intercessor, respect him, or tell your neighbor, respect an intercessor. Tell your next neighbor, respect an intercessor. Amen. If you find an intercessor, respect him. They are doing something powerful, something powerful, something dramatic. Respect him. So warfare is establishing the will of God in spite of opposition or battle. That means Satan say no, you say no, God's will must prevail. That's warfare. War and fair in the war. Faring well in the war. And you know what? Prophecy cannot be fulfilled without warfare. Intercession, interceding. Now, there are some things I wrote that I want you to note. Write this down. Number one, the biblical approach for every affliction is prayer. Prayer is the biblical approach for every intercession. If you're a ministry person here, I'm giving you raw material. Your ministry will only rise by intercession. Every affliction, those affliction church members have, can only be solved in the place of prayer. Thank God for your doctor. Thank God for makeup and all of that. God said, is any afflicted? Let him pray. James chapter 5, verse 13. Every other means you want to route, this one, God says, number one, this is prescription. So prayer is divine prescription for every affliction. Every. James chapter 5, number 13. So the biblical approach for every affliction is pray. That's why I said, pray in everything. Pray. Don't say it's too small. How can I pray? It's too small. Pray in everything. Pray. Number two, I wrote down here, in prayer, your spirit connects with the Holy Ghost for solution. In prayer, your spirit connects with the Holy Ghost for solution. In other words, when you are in prayer, your spirit man tap into the realm of where the Holy Ghost is, mingling with your spirit as a witness to bring you solution. In prayer, your spirit connects the Holy Ghost for solution. Romans chapter 8, verse 26 down to 27. He said, but the Spirit helpeth our infirmity. It's only in the place of prayer I can do that for you. Help is your most needed help. And if you don't have it, you're helpless. For he, you know, but the Spirit make an intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. Tuta, prakuta, shia. Somebody said, oh, how can I be praying? They won't understand. He said, no. He said, you don't understand it. You're talking to God. Only God understands. Keep praying it. Keep praying it. And God says, you pray it. You are routing solution in the realm of the Spirit. And what's more? When you don't pray, there's a repetition of problem. I wrote these things down when I was preparing. When you don't pray, there's a repetition of problem. That means, when I see that your problem is repeated all the time, it's a proof that you're not praying. Because I say, come unto me, all ye that labor, and I will give you rest. So why are you not finding rest? If the problem is repeated and persistent every day, you're having problem, you're not praying. Could it be? Yes. If you don't pray, you will experience repeated problem. That's what it means. Look, don't joke with these 21 days that's coming. It's a destiny molding days. Destiny transforming days, please. Don't miss it for anything. And what's more? Number what now? Let's go to the next call of time. I'm showing you the reason why you must pray. Number five. Number four, I said it's a warfare intercession. I just wrote some things for you to note. But number five is a platform for transformation and growth. It's a platform for transformation and growth. It's a platform for transformation and growth. The meaning of that is, it's in prayer you are transformed. It's in prayer that you grow. Growth requires responsibility. Luke chapter 9, verse 28 and 29. Jesus took Peter, James, and John on the mountain to pray. While he was praying, there he was transfigured. It came to pass about 8 days after this saying that he took in Peter, John, and James and went up to the mountain to pray. This 21 days is our mountain. It's a 21 days mountain experience. And as he was praying, the fashion of his countenance altered, changed, transformation. There is an alteration. And his raiment was white and glistering, dazzling. He has changed. Yes, from the realm of man, mortality has become immortal. Prayer changes you from a man to a God. Prayer converts you from a mortal man to an immortal personality. Where whatever God can do, you can do. You can operate at God's frequency. You can walk by the anointing of God in the place of prayer. Now listen. Prayer enhances your spiritual discernment. Your ability to discern. What do we mean by discernment? Your faculty of perception. That means where you can discern things, happenings. That's why I said, if you're not prayerful, you are spiritually dead. You can't see what God is showing. You can't hear what God is speaking. Some people ask me, God has never ever spoken with me. How does God speak? Yes, you can't hear because you're not in prayer. I will stand upon my watch and hear what shall say to me. So it is when you're in prayer that you hear. Hear me now. How does God speak to you? When you're in prayer, those thoughts that jump into your heart, most of them God is talking to you. So prayer is not only a place of gimme, 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 gimme. It's not a place of bread and tea. It's a place of transformation. Take Paul Enetche said how he got to know he should do ministry. He was to travel abroad after he had studied as a medical doctor. He wanted to go and practice. But there was a burden in his heart, so he went on a 3 days fast. He said, there, God said, thou shalt serve me forever in ministry. A medical doctor and everything. Okay, no problem. Today, can you ever compare any medical doctor to him? How many of you don't call NHL? Okay. That's one of my mentors. Praise God. Not mentor by distance, one-on-one access and grace. So, I've drawn from him. I believe all he says. Praise God. So, what am I saying? Prayer is a place of transformation, a place of growth, a place of change. Your spirit man come alive. Your faith is intact. So prayer is not... let me tell you our problem. Most of the time, we come to God only when we have need. Oh God, I want to buy land. Oh God, job. Oh God, husband. Oh God, wife. That struggle will not end though. You will still be wanting it. But if you can carry God, everything is in place. Are you with me? Can I pray for you? In these 21 days prayer and fasting, I see your life change for good. I see your destiny transform in the name of Jesus. Should I continue? Are you sure? Okay, quickly. How do I make my prayer effective? I've shown you 5 reasons why you must pray. How do I make it effective? Maybe I'll just give you 3 because time will close. 3 ways. 3 effective approach to prayer. 3 effective approach. Number 1, you refuse to be offended in God. Lord, that's how I prayed 21 days last year. They say you will do something. I didn't see anything, but you are alive. If you are alive, if they prove it is something. Matthew 11:6. Refuse to be offended in God. If you refuse to be offended in man. Matthew 11:6. Also, Acts 24:16. He said, I refuse to be offended in both man and God. I have exercised my conscience to have my conscience void. God has never done you any evil, sir. Man. The church have never done you any evil, sir. Man. Some people say, hey, I won't come to that church again because of that brother, because of that sister. Is it the sister you're coming to see in church? Is it the brother you're coming to see in church? You're offended in God. The church is called the body of Christ, not the sister. Hello? Please, if your name is Mary, don't be offended. Say, hey, because Sister Mary, I won't come. What Sister Mary do to me? You know, I need to say that before somebody say, hey, somebody have told pastor about me, Mary. What I'm saying is this. You are not coming to church because of any man or any woman. You're coming to meet with God. Your destiny to be transformed. So, refuse to be offended in God. Refuse to be offended in church. The church has not done you any evil. That's how your prayer becomes effective. If you're offended in God, who will now answer your prayer? When you are offended in God, you break your defense. Am I communicating? Am I blessing you? Number 2, pray with faith. Pray with faith. Hebrews 6:11-6. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. When you pray, believe that God will answer. God is angry with your doubt. Your doubt. So many people doubt God too much. God wants you to believe Him. If God tells you to carry your hand to be walking on the ground, you better carry your hand to be walking. It's better for you. It's for your good. Because you can't know more than Him. He told Abraham, after Abraham waited for how many years, come and kill your son Isaac. Does that make sense? Does it make sense? It doesn't make sense now. But He knows what's better for Him. In other words, I have something better, but you must pass this test. Whatever He tells you to do, do. They were in an occasion and wine finished. So they came and met him. The wine has finished. So he told them, put water in the drum. They said, we say wine has finished. Some of you know, he said, water in the drum. He said, put water in the drum. They went and told his mother, Mary. He said, look at this, your son. Don't understand how he's behaving. We told him wine has finished. He said, put water in the drum. The mother said, well, you don't know that man. I know him. I spent some time with him. Whatever I tell you to do, do it. John 2:5. And after
after they put water in the wine, the next thing he told them again, another miraculous instruction, ridiculous instruction. Carry from the water from the drum, not from clean water, from the drum. Go and give the governor. Hey, this guy wants to kill me. This guy wants to kill me. And they went to him one again. He said, whatever I tell you to do, I've told you to do it. And the Bible said, this is the beginning of his miracle. Look, God will use the ridiculous to confirm the miraculous. Any ridiculous instruction God give you is for your miraculous transformation. I tell you, sir. And as he did, so when the governor drank, he said, what? Where did this one come from? Which supermarket did they buy it? Where did they import it from? So, what do? Have faith. Whatever you desire, when you pray, believe. And you shall, you shall have. Believe. If you don't believe, you don't have. So these 21 days, everything you write down that you're expecting, believe that God will answer. Then you have them. I don't care how they big, how they look. You saw that sister who stood in the altar this morning to share testimony. She brought a report. Doctor, I saw it, they say, 3 masses on her stomach, which will hinder the birth of the child. I said, what do you want? I've learned by revelation not to tell too much story. When you come to me, hey, pastor, this matter is very big. Wait, let me explain to you. I'm not patient to hear you. You want to, somebody say, oh, let me explain from the Genesis. So that I don't need Genesis, I have revelation. I know the end. What do you want? And that's how I ask her. You know, because some people, when you tell them, so what do you want? They thought you caught them. I didn't caught you. I try to give you solution. I don't need, the problem is not my concern. Because sometimes if you wait for them to finish, they will even kill your faith. They will kill your faith. You see, pastor, one thing just fly in my roof. As it fly in my roof, then I do me something in my leg like this, and I sleep again. And that story is too long. What do you want? Somebody say, hey, they're attacking me in my office. They're attacking me here. So what do you want now? Simple. Because if you listen to them tomorrow, they kill your faith before your time. When you would have used unction and prayer, cast out that devil. When they have finished the story, you said, okay, you just carry a while ago. In Jesus' name. But if they allow you, pastor, there's a challenge. I need you to join me in faith. Please speak a word. I need serious intervention. Speak a word. Yes. Then you have provoked the anointing in me. The anointing is for solution. And I speak a word, and your freedom comes. And you return back with testimony. So she came with it. Something, and explained how doctor is saying this and that. I said, so what do you want? She said, save the evening. And the mass, 3 mass. I said, 3 mass? Destroy. Go back for test. Return with testimony. Just there and go. That prayer was no more than 2 minutes. Did she not stand there today to share the testimony? When she brought the report some days back, even myself, I was surprised. How in 3 days, less than 3 days, the mass, is it up to 3 days? It's not up to 3 days. Okay. The 3 mass fried. When they went back, the doctor said, what happened to you? Anybody that come here, things happen to them. I don't care any report in your life, any negative report. But I speak now that those negative reports are fried. I said they are fried in the name of Jesus. So have faith in God. And what more? Number last, walk in obedience. Walk in obedience. Whatever I tell you to do, do it. One of the things that also hinder people from connecting with answers is disobedience. For example, you want spiritual growth. You take responsibility. Read your Bible. Pray. Whatever I ask you to do, do it. You want financial breakthrough, be a giver. Pay your tithe. You want all year-round blessing, give your first fruit. What is your first fruit? Your general salary. That's a ridiculous information. Instruction. Have practice if it works. God can, every statement of scripture is a prophetic verdict. It confirms everything. Somebody told me one time, he said, it's not easy. God does not tell you to do easy things. If God tell you easy things, then your blessing will be eased out. How can somebody wait there for 100 and some years, have a child, and that's it, should bring it to kill him? But today, he's the father of what? By passing that test. He said, pay your tithe. I will keep the heaven, open the heaven. He said, pastor, I study mathematics. I'm a professor of mathematics now. remove 10% from this thing, what is remaining now? If 10% is not enough, how will 90 be enough? Simple calculation. How will 90 be enough? Are you there? He said, be a soul winner. Say, Pastor, check now. Am I a pastor? How can I be going to be winning soul? You two check now. What will I tell them? Where will I start preaching from? Me that doesn't even know the Bible. I don't even know Genesis. Don't talk of Revelation. Where will I go from? Share your testimony with them. Jesus loves you. Come and meet with Jesus. Where will meet to him? He will send his word and transform you with heaven. That's how to preach. Share your testimony. That's how to preach. You don't need to preach like Pastor K. No. Preach your preaching based on your level of testimony. Do you know I preach more people in the street and get more people saved in the street without than your altar? Yes. I preach more in the street, get more people saved in the street other than this. Steady, regularly. Because I know the value of what's in it. Pray kingdom and gospel prayer. Now we have rolled out the vision of 2020. There'll be steady outreach and engaging it. These ones now are what we call keys of the kingdom. These are the things that you require for your transformation. You see that everywhere is quiet. Because you're telling them inside things. The cocoa, say cocoa. The under bottom pot. When you chop, when you're chewing chicken, there's a place that is very, very. That's where people sit. Now, I give you one scripture and I close. Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 1. Put it on the screen. Put it on the screen quickly as I close. Thank you, Jesus. And it shall come to pass, if thou shalt diligently hearken unto the voice of thy God. Where is his voice? His word. It's his instructions. The things he tells you to do, do it. You're not wiser than him. I'm not wiser than him. Not even there are churches who doesn't believe in certain things in this Bible. They are not wiser than the word of God. Before the church was formed, the word existed. Are you hearing me? Now, because nobody will have the word revelation of scripture, we know in part. If you hear anybody, I've told you before, we say God called him to preach the whole Bible, run away from that person. You must have an aspect they call you to preach, which will be a product of your experience, your encounters. You can't preach everything. Praise God. You say, hey, our ministry, where I used to come, they don't used to believe in laying of hands, or they don't used to believe in handkerchief. Or, that's their level of limitation based on the revelation of the founder. You don't use your personal doctrine to form corporate generalized doctrine. Look, in God's dealings with men, am I talking too much? Now, listen. In God's dealings with men, there are generalized dealings and there are personal dealings. Now, I've had people who say, it's not good to have more than 3 children because of this, that, and that, and that. So, you see, because God told me that if you want to be a prophet, you should not have more than 3 children. And they're not using the form doctrine in their church. So any member from that church, when you see people who have 4 children, you say they are messed up, they are ghosts, they are part of them. Because you too, you don't know the Bible. Are you there? God gave that man personalized dealing from the kind of work God wants to have with him. Are you there? He now came and generalized it. Whatever is in this book, this is the final authority. I can disobey any man to apply this book. This book is final. It was born before any man existed. Whatever I tell you to do, if thou shalt diligently hearken unto the voice of the Lord, what will happen? And observe to do all his commandments. Say all. Say all. Say all. Because some people say, what if I do some? I don't do some. Why not strive to do all? All of them carry their own benefits. To do all his commandment, which I commanded thee this day, that the Lord thy God shall do what? Shall do what? Where? Only in Bamenda? Only in Fonchar Street? Only in Metaquarters? Only in Tarikon? Only in Kwe? All nations are there. All nations. That's breaking limits. So, your obedience limits. Are you blessed? Did you receive anything? Jump up on your feet and shout a praise.